हेलो। साकेत
माइक को इंट्रोड्यूस हो सॉरी क्विक कॉल आउट इंटर वीडियो तरह इमीडिएटली ट्रांजिशन टू स्पीकर ऑन द स्क्रीन आई एम ड्रॉपिंग फ्रॉम द कॉल
So hi people. I'm Vinay. So today I'm going to talk about like deep learning with biology, like how those two fields can be intersected to take deep learning to the next level, basically. So let me start with the presentation. Yeah. So this is like the topics that I'm going to. Is it audible now? Is my voice audible?
Yes, you are.
Yeah, thanks. So about research papers I was telling, so there's like lot and lot of research papers that are coming every day. Every other day you see a new deep learning model which gives you a pinch of more accuracy than the previous best model. So how do you crunch all this information and how do you begin with reading a research paper? So I'm going to tell about that, and then I'm going to discuss about my GSOC project which I had done in the last summer. Just a second. Hope you all can see my screen now. Yeah. So And I'm going to talk about my GSOC project as well, which I have done in the last summer. So I thought it is a good example it's a good example use case where we can take concepts from the biological field and from the deep learning field, and we can do something nice, which is actually purposeful. And then I'm going to discuss my views about what takes deep learning to the next level, to the next revolution, or such, right? So let's start with the presentation. So beginning with why deep learning, a heads up that I have to give you all. So I'm not going to discuss about what deep learning is and how does it work, like the concepts like activation functions and like optimizers, like these function these things that go into deep learning. I think like it's better for you to learn from the from like courses or anywhere, like because like there are like a lot of courses, tech blogs, articles, videos, they're in any format that you can consume. So I don't want to bore you with all like going into depths of all these things, so like how do they work. But if you are a new person who's a person new to deep learning, then in the end I'm going to share some resources as well, so that you could use them to learn deep understand the concept of deep learning, and then you can comprehend this talk as well. So the inspiration behind deep learning basically came from this thought, like why couldn't machines learn on their own? Like when we are able to see a face and recognize it the next time, why can't we make a machine make it recognize a face, right? What the researchers have done is that this process of recognition is a phase. They try to break it as an algorithm. So deep learning is nothing but an algorithm and combined with mathematics. So that was the basic inspiration, or to see why the machine, if we are able to provide the data, why can't machines learn like we do, right? So that's how the idea revolution came up. And the person you see on the screen, he is Mr. Geoffrey Hinton. He is regarded as the father of deep learning. Like he was one of the first persons to pioneer the research on neural networks as well. So so where we are currently marching with deep learning is towards AGI. AGI is nothing but artificial general intelligence. So that means that if we could teach the common sense that a normal and average adult human has to a machine, like if the machine can be can think of its can feel the things, make sense around what it is seeing, then we would say we achieved artificial general intelligence. So all the researchers around the world are now marching towards trying to take deep learning towards artificial general intelligence as well. And this is how a deep learning neural network will be looking in this architecture has been taken inspiration from our brains only. So each of this unit is called a neuron, which are present in our brain as well. So the computer people have modeled this neuron as an individual computational unit. So each of this neuron can do a small computation, and the output can be passed to other neurons and other neurons, and finally we'll be getting an output. So like this process again, this can be explained In like many this has been explained many in many articles, so I would suggest you to like learn from that as well. And basically this interconnections between the neurons is basically the magic, where the magic happens. So if we could improve the connections, the way they are getting connected, the way information is passed from the forward pass to the backward pass. Forward pass is nothing but from the input layers to the output layers. Backward pass is how the deep learning model actually learns. The feedback is propagated from the output layer to the input layer, right? So it's basically we have to explore more on the architecture of the deep learning. Coming to the math behind deep learning, right? So nowadays there are like many frameworks, right? Keras, scikit-learn, TensorFlow, PyTorch, these are all like these can be used to do deep learning frameworks, though scikit-learn is mostly focused with machine learning models. So this makes it easier for us to skip all the mathematics and directly import TensorFlow as TF and then start coding the model, right? Would suggest you to start learning with the mathematics only, instead of like trying to build a model model in the framework, because this mathematics helps you a lot actually. When you are researching, if you want to be a researcher, a deep learning researcher, you need to understand at least the basics of statistics field, the probability field, calculus field, and the linear algebra field. So basically these four fields drive the field of deep learning as well. So having a basic understanding of these will make it easier for you to comprehend all the concepts. And the reasons why I tell you need to learn math for deep learning is that it makes it intuitive for you to understand what is actually happening under the hood. Like most understand deep learning as a black box, like when you give data and input, you will be getting the output, but how does the magic work is the answer to that question is mathematics only. It's simple mathematics. And in case if you are aiming to pursue a research in deep learning, then you must be having some strong mathematical foundation for you to pursue research, because like you need to be innovating, like you need to be taking the previous methods, you need to be seeing what is actually happening in that method, and you will be finding ways to improve that method. So you need some mathematical knowledge as well for that. And also I feel like one who has a knowledge on how the things work, things the procedure like backpropagation. Again, this backpropagation is a concept, is the core concept of deep learning by which everything actually works. So for that also, I'll be providing resources in the end if you are not aware of what backpropagation is. So you would be able to, when you're writing the code, right, in the Python language or language of your choice, so you will be able to better debug your neural network, because neural networks are usually hard to debug because there will be no error for you, and yet you will not be getting any output as well. So that's what makes deep learning debugging neural networks very difficult. So if you are aware of the mathematics that is happening, if you are aware of the slope of the graph, that how does that decrease and how does the weights of the neural network each as we keep training the model, so you would be able to like pinpoint each step and say that, oh, maybe this there's something wrong with the data flowing at this step or at this layer of the neural network. So ultimately you will be able to debug your neural networks in a faster way. And the most important reason why I think maths is necessary, because it gives you the opportunity to question everything, rather than just learning rather than just learning some new optimizer that has come up from a new latest research paper or a new activation function that promises to be better working than the previous ones, like ReLU and all. ReLU is nothing but an activation function mostly used, popularly used in deep learning algorithms. So it allows you to experiment and come up with your own optimization techniques. It allows you to come up with your own loss functions so that you could be solving a problem which maybe did not get any traction for other from other researchers. So these are the reasons I think that maths will be useful. And also there's this question that comes often: do you really need to go into of each of this field if you want to be say a deep learning engineer and a deep learning researcher, right? So I would like to think that the deep learning engineer and a deep learning researcher's job is different. Though they do the same thing, they learn the same thing, they have the same amount of like knowledge or in many cases, I think their job is different. Like deep learning researchers would have to try to invent new things, and deep learning engineers would have to try to implement the already promised ones, like which ones would be giving the best result. They would be researching on that and then taking that. So I'm saying, like, if you want to be a deep learning engineer in some company or something like that, to worry about the extreme depths of going into the mathematics and understanding every thing in very detail. I'm saying you can be okay with having some placeholders instead of actually knowing what is going in depth. But if you are going to be a deep learning researcher, then it would be essential for you to learn all the mathematics, I believe. And these are some right? Linear algebra, multivariate calculus, probability, and statistics. These four are very important fields of mathematics which drive deep learning. And in case if you are not confident about your mathematics, or if you feel mathematics is something higher that you are not able to comprehend, it's nothing like that. Maybe the reason is that we had bad teachers or something. Actually, maths is like really beautiful. So I would strongly suggest all of you, even if you are new to mathematics, or if you are an expert and if you want to refresh your concepts, I would suggest you to go to 3Blue1Brown YouTube channel. The name there's a math person, he runs the YouTube channel. His name is Grant Anderson. So I strongly recommend you to check out his videos on linear algebra and calculus. So he makes interactive visualizations like which would explain you the concept very intuitively. And also I would suggest you to take on Khan Academy, which is also free, and it's a great course as well. It introduces to a concept called gradient descent as well. Gradient descent as well, which is very important for deep learning, in the field of deep learning. After that too, after once you've learned the mathematics of what how everything works, so I would suggest you to build a neural network in only NumPy. In only NumPy, because like it is easy to take a framework. It is easy to start building let us say for Keras. Like if you want to build a neural network in Keras, like you can do it like in 2 minutes, because that framework made it that easy for you to do it. But if you want to test yourself on the mathematics that you've learned, and how if you really understood how to connect things, then building a neural network from NumPy from scratch would be a great way to see how much you are able to understand. And even if you make any mistakes, you'll be that you can use it. Actually, that knowledge will be useful for you when you keep going into the next concepts. And for math, I would also suggest with start reading research papers as well on deep learning, and I'm going to discuss about that as well in just a bit. And try to replicate the results from these research papers. Like when you try to replicate the results from those research papers, it's a challenging process actually, because you would be trying to develop on your own, and you would actually learn a lot of things as you keep practicing converting research papers to code. So when I was reading the research papers, and when I was trying to replicate their results, I faced many difficulties, and I went into a rabbit hole problem. Is like there'll be something that I don't understand, I will Google that, and then there in that explanation there'll be something that I don't understand there as well, so I'll be Googling that and that and that, like that it will be going, but my progress on the research paper wouldn't move. So I'm going to share some tips on how I manage to start reading research papers. And yeah, if you're just starting, the first important point is like if you're just starting out, like if you're starting learning deep learning and all, I would suggest you not go with the research papers, because there'll be a lot of research papers usually tend to write high level language in the sense like they'll be using tech jargons which are actually appropriate, but for a beginner it wouldn't make every sentence you read, you'll be having like 2-3 words that you don't understand. So it's not advisable. It makes you feel that it is some kind of a rocket science that you can't comprehend. So I would suggest you to build upon your concepts and build upon your mathematics, and then start reading papers, right? And once you've done that, so when you open a research paper, first I would suggest you to read the abstract and introduction properly. So that is where you get to know the gist of the paper, what the paper is actually trying to tell, what are they working on, why do they think this the model proposed in that particular paper is better than the previous ones. And you can also find answers to questions like why they took that approach and why not the other approach. So there'll be a lot of questions that you can answer with just reading the abstract and introduction only. And then I would suggest you to read the paper from top to bottom once, like in the first read, just go through that. Like even if there might be many words that you don't understand, many concepts that you don't understand, so take a note of all of them, and the questions that you get while you are reading, take a note of all of them, but do not stop reading. So the moment you stop reading and start searching about something you don't understand, it starts the rabbit hole problem that I've discussed just now. Just you to go through the research paper from top to bottom at least once, and keep noting the points that you want to explore and also the questions that you get. And in the second read, concentrate on these questions that you have. Like when you reach that question in the second read, so then start Googling and try to understand what it actually happens. Like what is actually happening. So after you complete the second read, you'll be clearing some concepts, a few things which are now clear, but still you may have a few more questions as well. So then you go to the third read. Then you, even if it's the fourth read, fifth read, it's fine, because like when people are starting out, it's difficult for everyone. Don't worry about having to read the research paper multiple times, because it is essential to do so. It is essential to build that skill of reading research papers and understanding what people are trying to tell. And want, like after you've understood the research paper, when you want to make them like replicate their results, right? So the first thing that you would look at would be the model architecture block diagram. So that would give you a lot of information on how the layers are connected in the neural network, and how each like you would also get to know what are they introducing new in the architecture. Like if you are aware of the basic convolutional neural network, let us say a convolutional neural network architecture, which is basically a deep learning model which mainly focuses on extracting features from images and making sense out of images. Basically, you can find them anywhere on object detection from images, image classification. CNNs are a great invention, actually. So if you are aware of a basic CNN structure, then you could easily compare the basic CNN structure with this model architecture diagram, and you could relate to most researchers would be. Yeah. Hello. Okay, so after you look at the model architecture block diagram, you could then start looking at the implementation details that they mentioned. You could actually look for them in the results section or in the proposed system section. Usually the papers would have such sections, so where they'll be mentioning the details about the data set that they've used and how they pre-processed that data set, which is a very important step to do, and also the hyperparameters they've used. Hyperparameters in the sense like there are a few concepts which would enable you to train deep learning neural networks in a better way, something like a learning rate, a batch size, some additional layers like batch normalization. So all these words, please don't worry about them. These are like easy to comprehend once you start actually learning them. So I'll as mentioned before, I'll be providing some resources as well to learn them. And so I would suggest you to follow these tips, which I found to be very useful for me. When I started trying to replicate research papers and convert them to code, these tips actually helped me much. And moving to my GSOC project, basically why I thought of discussing my GSOC project here is that it involved the concepts of both biology and deep learning, and I just wanted you you present a use case example use case where both these full fields can come together and which would help in a make building a project something like this. So I want to like introduce you to the project actually. So there is an open source organization called INCF which deals on the field of neuroinformatics basically. So it is a frequent participator of the GSOC program. GSOC program is the Google Summer of Code program that every summer Google organizes. It's an open source program as well. So all the open source organizations would be participating in the program, and there'll be projects for which students can start applying for. So there's one such project that I did in the last summer, in the 2019 summer. And the INCF organization, right? So it is like an umbrella organization. And under that INCF organization, there are many sub-organizations. So OpenWARM is something, is a sub-organization that I have done my GSOC project for. So OpenWARM, basically, its aim is to build the first ever digital organism. Right, so about building a digital organism, why don't we like what is the use, right? That's the question that we may think about. So it's basically the thinking goes like this, like when we want to try to understand the human anatomy, the human neural structure and how the nervous system is connected, basically how the human body works. It's actually very difficult to experiment directly on humans, and if you consider just the brain, there are like billions and billions of neurons within a human brain. So it would not be possible to explore all that information at once, right? So usually taking a basic step towards it, we try to analyze microorganisms which have a similar genome to the human genome. A genome is nothing but it's a complete set of DNA which would have the entire information on how any living organism works, like its specific characteristics that they exhibit. All that information is in the genome only. So worm called C. elegans. It's a type of a round worm. It is basically found near like in our household as well, on vegetables which haven't been cleaned in a long time. So these worms are very similar to how humans work, but it's like a mini light version of a human because it only has around 302 neurons only, whereas a human has around billions and billions of neurons, and us and this also have a simplified that is similar to again our human's nervous structure. So the researchers are trying to understand this organism so that they will be able to comprehend, they will be able to use that extracted information and try to understand the human anatomy, right? So that's the reason why we are studying this organism, this microorganism. And it's not just INCF that is doing. If you go around the world and see and meet researchers who are into researching microorganisms to understand human anatomy and stuff. So C. elegans is a popular model organism. It's like the hello world basically. You have to know, when you get into the biology field, you would be knowing about C. elegans. So the aim of our project, my GSOC project, is that like when this C. elegans it forms from an egg. From the egg, there will be one cell that comes out, and that cell keeps dividing, keeps dividing, keeps dividing, and this until it gets into an adult like the image that you see here. So this process is actually called embryogenesis, like the process of going from one cell to an adult, complete adult. This process actually takes 13 hours of the time, 13 hours to happen. And a researcher would have to sit at the microscope and observe the cells and note the details of at which time point in this 13 frames, 13 hours time frame, there'll be specific stages as well within this embryogenesis process. Let us just say just stage A, stage B, stage B, stage C, or something like that. So the researcher would have to note down the details on when did the let's say 1,000 cells appear in the time frame. When did 500 cells appear? So those characteristics needs to be looked at to find out if the worm is growing in an expected manner or not. So basically, a researcher would have to spend 13 hours of his time, her time, to be at the microscope. So the aim of my project is to pre-record that microscopy images of the worm evolving from a single cell to a complete adult, and then pass it to a deep learning algorithm, which would be able to tell as the process goes on. So basically what happens is that the 13 hours of researcher manually updating the field, manually updating the number of cells, their centers, their center points and information like that, it just becomes to 13 hours of recording the video and just 1 minute of passing into the deep learning and getting the results. So that was basically the aim of the project. So I felt that it's a good use case for anyone trying to understand what kind of projects that they could do combining the biology concepts from biology and also the deep learning side. And after some literature survey, we happened to decide on a model architecture. This is just to show you the model architecture of the deep learning model that we have built. But I'm not going to explain about this, what is happening inside this. I thought it would be useful for you to see how the model architecture looks like in a paper. So if you go to any paper, find such model architecture and try to build each component one by one slowly. So once you have the full model, you could try to then you're almost 50% done already. So I'm just trying to show you the model that we have used, some results that we are attaching. I attached some results as well. The left side that you see, that is the embryo that is happening to, like, it is in the process of dividing, getting the cells divided, right? So this process was actually very challenging because we didn't have any labeled data in the sense we did not have any information on where the cells are located. Any previous information on where the cells are located, so that we could show it to the deep learning algorithm, so that that deep learning algorithm can can understand the logic understand where to find the locations, based on the features extracted from the original image, from the input image. So we didn't have that information. So we tried some in an unsupervised approach. We used something called in the classical image processing techniques, there is something called మార్ఫాలజికల్ అనాలిసిస్ అగైన్ మార్ఫాలజికల్ అనాలిసిస్ ఇస్ నథింగ్ బట్ అ స్మాల్ బ్రాంచ్ ఆఫ్ ఇమేజ్ ప్రాసెసింగ్ మోస్ట్లీ రిగార్డ్ ఎస్ దిస్ క్లాసికల్ ఇమేజ్ ప్రాసెసింగ్ ఇట్ హెల్ప్స్ అస్ టు it's very much it's widely used those techniques are widely used in the biomedical imaging field so when you want to pre-process an image so you would want to remove all the noise harm the deep learning model's output so in the process of removing that noise you would be employing some morphological analysis techniques So I'll be providing some resources on that as well, where you can learn them. And then, coming to the result section again. The image that you see here, this is what the deep learning model was able to output, right? So as this was an unsupervised approach, we didn't reach the the optimized solution yet. So and again so this project got extended to GSOC 20 which is happening now and I'm also co-mentoring that project so it if you can see it was able to identify the background to which it gave as a green color and the region that you see it provided it with the red color and the boundaries that you could see it provided it with the blue color but still it is so noisy that this information is almost like we couldn't use it at that point of time so we employed more classical image processing techniques so and that result showed something like this the picture that you see on the right side so we were able to identify the cell region and we were able to identify the center point as well so this is a project can be like this as well when you deal with the deep learning and biology and if I have to talk about taking deep learning to the next level I should tell that okay deep learning has achieved many incredible things right it has been able to generate new faces it has been able to generate new just images from just text information so it's doing a lot of great things Hello yeah sorry but has achieved so much of so many things which average human could do I still think it is dumb because it can only perform Hello there's a small network issue from my side I'm sorry I feel it's still dumb because it can only do any task that it has been trained on but when you consider artificial general intelligence it should be able to learn from the features that it extracts from things which are unknown right so a basic example that we could use is that let us say we humans, like when we see a face for the first time, you don't have to see it for like 1,000 times to remember the face, to recognize that face the next time you see the person, right? But deep learning still has to, we need to provide at least 1,000 samples of that of the face, so that it could try to relate, it could try to relate to what a face looks like and what doesn't look like a face, what doesn't look like a face. So I would say that so we could so there's something supreme that is happening within our brain. It may be the way it is structured, it may be the way the things are connected, it may be the way how neurons pass information and how it makes sense. So getting a complete understanding of that procedure will enable us to take deep learning to the next level and brings us closer to the artificial general intelligence, the benchmark that that is very high. And the reason there's also an example that I could that I brought here on the right side. You could see an image. This image is the embryo image that I showed in the last slide. So when I was doing my GSoC project, so I just there's a model called. So that deep learning model, basically, when you input an image, it will be able to identify the objects and locate the object where it has been, location of the object in the image. So when I uploaded my embryo image, it detected that embryo as a cat with like 99% of accuracy. Like it is 99% confident that this image is a cat. So that's why I'm telling, like, we are still a long way from achieving AGI. So what brings us there is a better understanding of how humans work. And I also have interesting research to share. There's this professor called Jack Gallant. He's a professor at UCB, which is the University of California in Berkeley. It's like one of the premium institute of the world where exciting research is always happening. So it's on the neuroscience of how we are able to comprehend, we are able to and see and understand things, like how does the vision of human works, how is our brain able to make sense out of the information, like whatever it's going through our eyes, right? So on that, and he encourages to as in set of algorithms, a set of algorithms where we could focus on each individual algorithm and understand how we are able to feel it may be any emotion, feel any emotions, or how we are able to remember stuff and how we are able to react to something something that is happening external to us. So these informations, or he believes that all this information is nothing but it's a process of an algorithm. So if we had a better understanding of our brain, so we could actually write an algorithm of why do we feel an emotion. There can be an algorithm for why we are feeling sad. There'll be an algorithm for why we are feeling conscious. So he aims for that one actually. And I have a small video to share which would show the research that is happening in the lab. So on the left side that you could see, that is a clip of a movie that has been shown to humans, and their brain activity is being recorded. Their brain activity, they're trying to reconstruct the images that the person in focus has been seeing. So I would like to say that we are on the way to, like, even though this is like very rough reconstruction, but it is still very impressive considering how complex our brains are and how tough it is to capture the brain activity and bring it into an image and capture the information and represent it in an image form. So I would like to conclude that understanding ourselves first and understanding our and being able to write our actions within as an algorithm, it better helps us to teach implement the same algorithms in a programmatical way, so that even deep learning models will be able to maybe one day they'll be able to feel the same things we feel. Maybe they'll be able to understand what common sense is, like the basic five senses like that we have. So that's why I feel if we want to take deep learning to the next level, we should start with biology. And that brings me to the end of this presentation. If you're having any questions, like where, if you want me to repeat any slides, or if you have any questions where something wasn't clear, please ask now, and also you could share your feedback as well. Having any questions, please put them in the live chat. I'll be seeing them. You can ask me anything, actually, not just related to anything related to deep learning. You could ask me, not just related to biology. So if you're having any questions regarding the topics I discussed, like the reading research paper section and the math behind deep learning section, please ask in the live questions. So that I could answer you. So meanwhile, people ask questions. So I just want to show you more about my GSOC project and the GSOC project that is happening now, like the project that I'm mentoring. Just a second, I would be sharing that information as well. Hope all of you can see my screen where Google Summer of Code, the dashboard, is open. Yeah, so I mentioned about the INCF open, it's an organization, right? Like it's an open source organization which focuses on neuroscience and neuroinformatics, the field. So there are like many sub-organizations as well, which participate into GSOC under the INCF organization, and and one such organization is the Open Mom organization. So this is the project that I am mentoring. So a second year student has applied to our organization, and we have like we really liked his approach on how we could improve the results that I've shown you in the presentation and that I could achieve. So he had an interesting approach of it's a high level approach actually. So you could also try for next year. Meanwhile, you could if you are a beginner, you could start building from now itself. Like the resources I'm going to provide, if you can follow them, that that would be great. And not just INCF organization for that matter, when you go through the list of organizations that are participating in the GSOC organization, so in the GSOC program, you could find a lot of projects related to your interest. Let it be deep learning with biology, let it be deep learning with media content, let it be deep learning with audio data. So there are a lot of organizations which have projects related to your interests. So you would have to explore. So regarding regarding the resources that I mentioned that I would share, so I would be putting all of them like resources for math, for deep learning, resources for reading research papers, resources for where to start for deep learning. I would be putting all those links and things in a doc, and I would be sharing it to Saketa so that he could share it with all of you who are watching the presentation right now. So please don't worry about that one as well. And if you are having any more questions, please put it in the live chat. And meanwhile, I would also thank the GVP AI Club and also Saketa who encouraged me to give this talk. I hope you learned on there's some new information that you could gather that you learned today. I hope you found this presentation to be informative. Like if you have any specific issues that you think I can help, you can always reach out to me on any social media, be it Twitter or LinkedIn or somewhere. Social media links as well in the doc that I share, and the resources doc. Yeah, like the for the math behind deep learning, I would suggest you if you are a books person, if you want to learn from books, I would suggest you to start with a book, Intelligence: A Modern Approach, by Peter Norvig, Stuart Russell. Peter Norvig is the research director of Google. He's like the senior most director who's leading DeepMind, which is their most prestigious project to achieve artificial general intelligence. So in the 90s, he has written a book called Artificial Intelligence: A Modern Approach. So you could use that book to Google Brain. He's an head of Google Brain, and you could use that book to basically you can use that book to increase your knowledge on how to think programmatically and how the basics of AI is there, like AI can be done, and if you want, and then you can start with there's a book called the Math by D. I don't remember the book name, but I will share that one as well. It's by Lee. That book has a lot of great stuff for mathematics. When someone wants to learn about the mathematics in depth, or if someone wants to learn about the proofs regarding the theories. And I would be sharing that book as well. And for the question regarding which websites are good for finding research papers, so there is this website called ArXiv, where most of the like leading research papers, the preprints of all the leading preprints of papers from leading researchers are available. So those are free of content. Those are free for anyone to open and read. And also, you can find the link in the chat as well for the ArXiv thing. And also, you could look for Google Scholars. There's this website that Google runs. So it's a collection of a wide variety of research papers where you could search for exactly what you're looking for any specific topic that you're searching, or for any research by any researcher that you are specifically searching for. These two papers are great websites. There's another website that is called paperswithcode.com. So basically, there are like now state-of-the-art models. There are like many state-of-the-art model. So most of their code is open.